Hello, and welcome to worship today. I am Pastor Janet Miller, and on this cold, terribly cold Sunday morning, I am glad that you took the time to come and to worship with us. The congregations that I serve, both Hope Lutheran and Summit, and the Florence Lutheran Parish, have all decided that it is too cold and too windy, and the roads are getting full and all of those things. So we are not having worship this morning. And so if you're any of those folks, make sure that you, instead of going to worship at 9 and 11, stay and worship with us. Now let's begin. Begin each worship with a time of confession and forgiveness. So let us pray. Almighty God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. People of God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all of our sins. So as a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Our hymn is number 798. Will you come and follow me? Will you come and follow me if I but call your name? Will you go where you don't know and never be the same? Will you let my love be shown? Will you let my name be known? Will you
scripture readings to read for you today. The first is from our Old Testament reading from the third chapter of Samuel, where we read, "Now the boy Samuel was serving the Lord under Eli, the Lord. The Lord's word was rare at that time, and visions weren't widely known. One day Eli, whose eyes had grown so weak he was unable to see, was lying down in his room. God's lamp hadn't yet gone out, and Samuel was lying at the Lord's temple, where God's chest was. The Lord called to Samuel. 'I'm here,' he said. Samuel hurried to Eli and said, 'I'm here. You called me?' 'I didn't call you,' Eli replied. 'Go and lie down.' And so Samuel did. Again, the Lord called Samuel. So Samuel got up and went to Eli. And Eli said, 'I'm here. You called me?' he said to Eli. 'I didn't call, my son,' Eli replied. 'Go and lie down.' Now Samuel didn't yet know the Lord, and the Lord's word hadn't yet been revealed to him. A third time the Lord talked to Samuel, and he got up and went to Eli and said, 'I'm here. You called me?' Then Eli realized that it was the Lord who was calling the boy. So Eli said to Samuel, 'Go and lie down. If he calls you, say, "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening."' So Samuel went to lay down where he'd been. Then the Lord came and stood there, calling just as before, 'Samuel, Samuel.' Samuel said, 'Speak, Lord, your servant is listening.' The Lord said to Samuel, 'I'm about to do something in Israel that will make the ears of all who hear it tingle. On that day, I will pass against Eli, and everything I say about his household, every last bit of it, of it, I told him that I would punish his family forever because of the wrongdoings he knew about, that his son had cursed God, but he would not stop them. Because of that, I swore about Eli's household and his family wrongdoings would never be reconciled by sacrifice or offering. Now Samuel lay there until morning, then opened the doors to the Lord's house. And Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli. But Eli called to Samuel, saying, "Samuel, my son." "I'm here," Samuel said. Our gospel lesson then comes from the Gospel of John, the first chapter, where we read, "Lord," Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas," which is translated to Peter, meaning the rock. The next day, Jesus wanted to go into Galilee, and he found Philip, and he said to him, "Follow me." Philip was from Bethsaida, the hometown of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law and the prophets, Jesus, Joseph's son from Nazareth." Matthew responded, "Can anything good come from Nazareth?" Philip said, "Come and see." Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward them and said, "Here is a genuine Israelite for whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "How do you know me?" Jesus answered, "Before Philip called you, I saw you under the fig tree." "Rabbi, you are God's son," Nathanael replied. "You are the king of Israel." Jesus said, "You believe me because I told you I saw you under the fig tree? You will see much greater than these. I assure you that you will see heaven open and God's angels going up and down to the earth on the human one." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Let's pray. Loving Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, our risen Lord and Savior. Amen. Well, our gospel lesson and our Old Testament lesson for today, which I read, you probably noticed a common theme in there, a theme of God's call to either Samuel or to Jesus to his disciples. And the thoughts about call and God's call into what he wants us to do in life made me think about the times that I have spent on different boards in our synod, especially to a board that was called the Candidacy Committee. The Candidacy Committee is a committee that all pastors who become pastors have to go through this committee. We have to do certain things to become a pastor. It's not just easy. You can't just say, poof, I'm a pastor and get to be a pastor. It just doesn't work that way in our church. Maybe it does in others, but it doesn't in the Lutheran church. There's a lot of steps you have to go through, a lot of education, and a lot of people along the way have to do something we call affirm your call. So to become a pastor in our synod, you have to first, not just in our synod, in anywhere in the United States, to become a Lutheran pastor for our denomination, you have to first apply to what they call the synod that you live in, the state that you live in or the place that you live in, and tell them, "I believe God is calling me to be a pastor." During this, when you go and first talk to them, they will send you things from a candidacy committee of some kind. And this committee each year has standard things that you have to do. The first thing is called entrance. You have to be entranced by meeting with certain group members from the committee on certain days, and they'll interview them, and probably the bishop will be there as well. Usually the bishop knows you before you get there, but they maybe not. And you have to write an essay, and you'll be given the scripture lessons and the theme of the essay and how your call from God can be seen through things in that essay. You kind of have to do that. You have to have letters of reference. I believe it was three or 4. I can't remember how many actually even, and that might change from state to state, but you have to have letters of reference. And I think you also have to, I don't know if it's at entrance, but somewhere along the line, you also have to have background checks to go into this. Well, once you're in entrance, what you do when you meet with the committee for the first time, one of the things they talk to you about, they say to you, tell me about your call from God. Because we believe in our church that to be a pastor isn't a job that you can just apply for. Here, I've got the things, I want to be a pastor, but that you need to be called from God. And that is why we call each of the new churches that we take a call. Instead of taking a new job, we take a new call. And the call paperwork is that the congregation calls you and that God calls you to these places. We believe that it's supposed to be all a work of God from the very beginning when you go to get your education and decide maybe God's calling you to be a pastor, all the way through your work as a pastor. That's how our denomination handles a lot of those things. So anyway, they start asking you about your call story. And I always think it's interesting that as people go around their journey, the call story kind of grows as people start to look back and see farther and farther that God was talking to me a long time ago about this, but I either just ignored it or didn't understand what God was getting to until he got me to this place. One of the things they always say for us to look for as call committee people is that in true calls from God, there is usually a call that is either ignored or there is pushback or there is total anger, upset, or I can't do that to God about. But there's always a little something kind of conflict in there, or usually is in the call story. I guess it's part of being human and being called to do something that's different in the eyes of most people in the work of God and in the work of church. And throughout, as I say, people go through the journey to be a pastor, they get entranced, and then once we accept them into entrance, we say, oh yes, it seems like you're a person that would be a good pastor, and it sounds like God is calling you. Let's call you in, get you educated, and see to make sure that this is a call that you can do and that you feel is truly something God is asking you to do. And then after you are entranced in, then you get into seminary somewhere. And it depends on which system you go through. Some people work while in congregation while they're going through seminary. Some go straight into seminary. Some do seminary online while they work other things. Now we have all these options. At one point we didn't, but now we have lots of options and ways to get through seminary to get to being pastor. And so you get, the next step is to get to seminary of some kind to be doing classwork. Well, when you're halfway through, my seminary by the time I started as an associate ministry, I did 2 years, and then I did 4 years as a pastor. There was 6 years in there that I was in with the candidacy committee because I came in as a person to be an associate ministry, got done with that, and within a year then started in as a person to go and be a pastor. It just was kind of, I was a person who didn't listen real well and dug my feet in, and God had to work me into being a pastor in a little different way. But anyway, as you go, you do your seminary, about halfway through, you have something that there are middle times where we interview and you do essays and we find out how you are doing and we get reports from the seminary. And then at the end, then we have a final where, again, you do another essay. We talk to you, and in between, the committee gets to know the seminary people as much as they can. We have certain people in the committee that are the contacts with them and things like that. By the end, we hope to know you enough and know your journey enough. And we hope that you have grown enough to be able to talk to you and to say, yes, we think you are a wonderful candidate and that you should be ordained into the ministry and the mission of our church. I was on the candidacy committee for 12 years. I was on a double shift of it because I was on special for special request of a bishop. And in those 12 years, we saw many, 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 many people go through. But there was only two ever that we said no to. One we said, not yet. And the other was that they said, no, we don't think you are ready to be a pastor yet in our congregations. And the one that they said not yet was a person who came in, had been a something like a lawyer or something, and had like $200,000 worth of debt, and then thought they were going to go to seminary, get another $30,000-$40,000 worth of debt, and then come back to South Dakota or somewhere and work on a pastor salary and be able to pay off that debt. Would have been an impossible thing to do. Nobody could have paid you enough as a beginning pastor, even for the first 10 years of your pastorate, for you to be able to make payments on that debt and not go under. And so what they told this person, it was that they needed to go and work in the world and pay that debt down and come back in a few years when there is less debt. And then they would let them become part of this system, because you have to report your debts and how your income and your debts to the people when you come into. There's a lot to becoming a pastor. I don't know if that person ever came back. I got done with the committee, so then what's happening isn't really my business as a pastor. And there was one other person who struggled with the process, whose call was just unlike any that we had ever heard, and who in the end decided that he didn't really want to be part of our church. He just wanted to be ordained and go and work for another denomination. And in the end, they said, no, we're not going to ordain you into ours and let you go and work somewhere else and be ordained in our denomination. So that's the only two I ever knew to get no's. But there are people who are told no, even after they've done their schoolwork. Because we value an educated pastorate, is what we call it. And we know that if we take people and we put them in congregations, they need to be healthy and they need to be able to handle all of the drama and things that come at you as a pastor before we can even put them into congregations. All of that is about call, too. Because, you know, sometimes, have you ever seen a person be a pastor or seen a pastor get in trouble and wonder, how in the world did that person get to be a pastor? Because we all went through all of the same rugged, you know, steps, and it was hard to get there and everything. And yet they seem to be doing everything against all the rules that we were told. And you got to wonder, gosh, did God make a mistake in calling this person, or what's going on? Is it that person's mistake? And you start to wonder. As I was thinking about this, about call and about some people who get in trouble as pastors and wonder about, or not trouble, sometimes pastors who just have worked a long time and gotten very burnt out, who wonder, am I really still called to do this work? And about where God is in all of that. I listened to somebody give a talk about it the other day, and I thought his answer to it was really interesting. He said, is it that God calls a bunch of people who he sees very good at these things and they go bad? Is it that God calls people who might not be great at something but just accepts them because they say yes? Or is it, in fact, that God is always calling all of us, everyone, and he works with those who say yes? That stopped me. That stopped me a lot. Because I thought, you know, that just might make sense in the world. After all, you know, to become a pastor, we kind of often joke and say that someone has to help you tune into the right frequency so you can hear what God is saying. Often it's another pastor who says, you would be a very good pastor. You need to start praying and think about this. But sometimes it's your father or father-in-law or child or friend. Sometimes it's just even a person who goes to church with you who says, you'd be really good at that. You should think about that. That starts us thinking along the lines of being pastors. Was it that God was always calling us to be pastors? Or was it that we are just people lucky enough to have someone turn our frequencies in the right place and heard the call from God because we started listening? I don't know for sure what the answer is about God's call, but I do know that in scriptures, God does not only call people who are ready to serve. Actually, he usually calls people who are ready to do absolutely anything else. God does not only call people who are educated to serve. Jesus did not have one rabbi among his group of people who were his followers. There were a lot of educated people around him he could have pulled in, but he did not. Excuse me. Not just that. In our Old Testament, God continues to use people who seem, if nothing else, ill-equipped and not ready. For instance, Samuel. Samuel was just a child when he was called by God. Like literally, God stood in front of him and called his name. And when Samuel finally was told that that was God and he should answer God, he should tune himself to the right frequency, he heard what God had to say. It was a tough thing that God told Samuel right away. But Samuel would eventually become one of the most famous prophets of the Old Testament. Samuel would become the first prophet to bring the kings of Israel and anoint them. He anointed King David, after all. Samuel, the prophet, who God called as a child, who was sleeping, tending the wicks in his temple because he had been given to the temple as a baby from his mother and raised by the temple people like Elijah. And God decided, this kid, he's the one that needs to be listening. He's the one I need to do this work, and he's the one I'm going to call. Interesting that God didn't seem to care if he was ready or if he had any skills for the job. God did the work as long as Samuel was in the right place listening. I think that, again, reminds us of what the speaker about call said. Is God really calling us all? Of course we are, excuse me, I got stuff in my throat today. We are not all called to be pastors. That would be ridiculous, to have a whole church full of pastors. It wouldn't happen first. But we're not all called to be pastors, but we are assured by Martin Luther, all called. You are called by God. If you're not hearing that call, it's probably because you're not listening to the right frequency. And so today, I want to be the person to tell you, turn your frequency. Start listening to something new. Start seeing when and where and how God is calling and pointing and pulling and cajoling and wanting you to be, to go, and to do. Because that's what God does. God, the maker of the universe, looks down and sees a problem or sees a blessing or sees a something that needs to be done, and he calls. Jim and Tim and Matt and Janet and you. He calls you. So today, let's remember to be more like Samuel. Let's turn our radios to the right station and say, speak, Lord. Here I am. I'm listening. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our hymn is number 659 in your red hymnals. Will you let me be your servant?
The Lord be with you, and also with you, on this day, especially to all of you who are homebound because it is so cold, and the roads are icky, and the wind is blowing, and winter has decided to actually come to us. May you experience God's peace. Peace be with you today. May you in some way pass it either to someone in your home, on the phone, online, or any way you can, because nothing stops God, not even distance. Amen. We also always remind you that we have a call for our tithes and our offerings to our God. If you would like to help to support the congregations that help to make this worship possible, you may do so by sending to either Hope Lutheran Church at P.O. Box 886 in Summit, South Dakota, 57266. We have a Venmo, which hopefully we'll have the Venmo up above us here. And you can stop the worship and you can take a picture of the Venmo with your phone, and it should be able to get you right to it so that you can give your offerings that way. Or we have automatic withdrawal opportunities. If you're a person who likes to do bills and payments that way, you may also do offerings that way to your God. Just contact me or Ani Sefrud, our treasurer at Hope. And if you would like to donate to the other congregations that help to make this possible, that would be the Florence Lutheran Parish, New Helgen Lutheran, and Goodhue Lutheran Churches. And you may do so by sending to New Helgen Lutheran Church at P.O. Box 5 in Florence, South Dakota, 57235. They also have opportunities for automatic withdrawal giving, if that's something that speaks to you. And we thank you. We continue on then with prayers for the people of God. With thanks and praise, on this day we come to you, our Heavenly Father. We thank you for the warmth of a home, for cars that work even when it is cold. We thank you for all of the gifts you give those of us who live in winter places. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all who are hurting and need in our world. We especially lift up those who are living in war, the people of Israel, the people of Gaza, the people of Ukraine, the people of Russia, the people of many different African countries, especially Sudan, who are suffering from a continent full of small wars or wars between countries. We pray. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are hopeless, those who are helpless, those who are even homeless, those in our world and those in our own country, and those who are in our own community who are in need of you. We especially lift up this day Brian, Kelly, Dan, Bobby, Dale, Dawn, Carol, Tom, Deb, Chris, Charlotte, Barry, Sharky, and all who we name in our hearts now. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We remember before you today those who have gone to heaven before us. And this day we especially remember Steve and his family. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all of our first responders as well. Those who work so hard as volunteers and those who are also paid. We pray that you uphold them, that you help their spirit when they go through and do their best, that you let them know how much we appreciate them and what a blessing they are. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For these things and all we need, we pray in our Savior's holy name. Amen. I do have to tell you folks of the list I read, I did not have our prayers for this week from either of our congregations. So if there are folks that should have been lifted up by name in prayer, I apologize. Please feel free to do so, and I will get them and make sure they are up in our list next week. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We also want to make sure everybody's praying for all those people that are outside working in the cold, whether you are farmers or are road workers or the people who have to get to work at hospitals and things like that. We pray our blessings and good travels on all of you. And we hope that the weather breaks and that we get more pleasant weather soon. Now, as I remind you every week, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and with mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen.
Our congregation of Hope Lutheran and the people of Summit have been hit with the second loss of a young father in just a couple months today. And I think that maybe the songs of I Know Who Holds Tomorrow would be good for us all to hear right now.
Our song is I Know Who Holds Tomorrow.
I just live from day to day. I don't borrow from its sunshine, for its skies have turned to gray. I don't worry o'er the future, for I know I know. sky. Maybe through the flame or flood, but his presence goes before me, and I'm covered with his blood. Many things about tomorrow I don't see to understand, but I know
also, as I remind you every week, be safe, especially today. It is cold. If you don't have to go anywhere, don't go anywhere. Stay somewhere safe. There's nothing more important than being safe. Be safe. Be smart. Okay? You're from South Dakota, or if you're not and you're just listening, you got to be smart in the cold. If you're not from around here, we've got 20 below zero with the 20 to 40 mile an hour wind and snow. It's a terrible, terrible day out there today. Be safe, be smart, be kind to each other, because our world really needs your kindness. And go in peace and serve our Lord. Thanks be to God. All right, folks. I love you. Be smart. Okay? We will see you. Stay home. Stay safe. Stay warm, and if you don't have to, bring along warm clothes. And we will see you next week. Bye-bye.